Physicists have always been interested in some of the biggest science questions ever, like, where did the world come from? Or, what is stuff? So far, searching for answers has led to incredible discoveries, from the Big Bang to the Standard Model of particle physics. But these discoveries aren't the end of the story, because they raise even more questions. We've talked about two of the biggest unresolved questions a lot on SciShow and SciShow Space, dark matter and dark energy. So here are four of the other biggest unsolved mysteries of fundamental physics. First, here's a question. Why can we remember the past, but not the future? What makes the two different? It might sound silly, but the laws of physics tell us that this is a legitimate question. Basically, the fundamental laws of physics are equations that can tell you how things change over time. They can tell you what happens to a system next, given its current state, but they also work just as well at telling you what happened to that system in the past. Like, you can use the same information to figure out where a rolling ball will end up, and where it was a few seconds ago. In other words, the laws of physics work equally well running the clock backwards and forwards. But that's not how we experience everyday life. We only experience time moving in one direction, forwards. And the reason why is entropy. Entropy is a physics concept that tracks how much disorder there is in a system. And in our everyday world, it always increases. Systems tend to get more disordered and messy as time moves on. That's because everyday things have huge numbers of parts interacting with each other, so there's always more ways for things to become disordered than to spontaneously order themselves. Like, there are just way more ways for globs of milk to scatter through your coffee than there are for all the milk to gather in one spot, so you never see your coffee run in reverse and unmix itself. So really, what we experience as time moving forward is just the universe flowing from low to high entropy. And that's where a big, unanswered question comes in. Where did all of this start? And why? Like, we know from cosmological evidence that the whole universe had a very low entropy beginning, the Big Bang. There, everything was squished into a tidy, small sphere. But why was the universe in that state? Why was entropy lower in the past? It should be much more likely for the universe to be in the maximum entropy state, the most disordered state possible, to the point where entropy couldn't rise anymore, and the flow of time wouldn't be possible. But instead, the universe started as highly ordered, which is such an unlikely thing to happen by chance that scientists are looking for an explanation. So basically, to a physicist, why can't you unmix coffee and milk, and why did the Big Bang happen the way it did, turn out to be kind of the same question. In terms of proposed solutions to this, well, they verge into philosophy. Some people say that the question doesn't even need an explanation. And even the suggestions we do have sound pretty wild. Like, one idea is that our entire observable universe is just a little, low-entropy bubble embedded in a much bigger, more chaotic, ever-inflating hole. But that's highly speculative, and, at least for now, probably impossible to test. Speaking of inflation, that's actually its own unsolved mystery of physics. About 40 years ago, cosmologists came up with an idea called inflation to explain many of the problems with the Big Bang model of cosmology. So now the question is, did inflation happen? And if so, what exactly is it? The Big Bang theory says that the universe started off small and dense and then expanded outward. The theory of inflation is an add-on to that, and it says that in the first tiny fraction of a second that the universe existed, it expanded at a much faster rate. Like, it inflated by a factor of 1 followed by 26 zeros in a time span of 0.30 zeros. 1 second. Talk about an early growth spurt. Most cosmologists believe inflation is real because it helps solve a few problems with the Big Bang model, and because they've seen most of its predicted effects in telescopes. The Big Bang model predicts that, on the largest possible scales, we should see notable temperature variations and some warping when we look deep into space. Except, the universe appears really homogeneous and doesn't appear to have any overall curvature. Everywhere we look, things are roughly the same, with similar distributions of things like galaxies and similar ambient temperatures. We also don't see any evidence of space being warped on the largest scales, the way we see space warping around a black hole. And for all of that, inflation would explain why. If that extreme growth phase happened, then the full universe is wildly bigger than what we can see. And if the part of the universe that we can see is really just a tiny fraction of the whole, it makes sense that it appears smooth and flat. It's like how the Earth is clearly curved and detailed when seen from the International Space Station, but if you zoom in on a small part of it, it can look flat and featureless. So really, inflation kind of says that our observable patch of the universe is the Nebraska of the wider cosmos. But not every scientist is convinced that this idea is right. Like, the idea of inflation also implies that there's a particle called the inflaton, but that isn't predicted by any physics theories, and we have no direct evidence for it. So some physicists have proposed alternatives to inflation, like the very abstract conformal cyclic cosmology model of Nobel laureate Roger Penrose, which says that there was an expanding universe before the Big Bang. The good news is, the next generation of telescopes and gravitational wave detectors may be able to identify telltale signals from inflation, and even tell us what type of inflation, if any, is real. So of all of the problems in this episode, this is the one we have the best chance of tackling soon. Next up is the fine-tuning problem, and it's about constants. Whenever scientists settle on physics theories, they always find numbers that appear as just brute facts. Like, take Einstein's E equals mc squared, which relates to mass and energy. The c stands for the speed of light, and we know that's about 300,000 kilometers per second. But we don't know why. And there are loads of constants like that, from an electron's mass to gravity's strength. By one count, there are 26 constants that are fundamental. They can't be explained as coming from a deeper theory, but just are. And that raises all kinds of questions. Like, if those numbers are truly random, there's quite the coincidence going on here, because if some of these numbers were even slightly different, life as we know it wouldn't be able to exist. For instance, if gravity was a bit stronger or weaker, stars wouldn't be able to produce the variety and abundance of elements needed for life to function. And there are other weird coincidences too, like that fundamental particles are less massive than it seems like they should be, given the forces acting on them. So what's going on here? It could be that there's a more fundamental theory we don't know yet that explains why these constants have the values they do, or maybe the answer lies elsewhere. Some researchers even speculate that there's a kind of multiverse where constants have different values and where physics works differently. Others take this idea even further and suggest that we only exist because we're in the universe suited to life. That last one is an extremely speculative idea, though, and since it's not something we could ever really test and provide evidence for, it also borders on unscientific. The truth is, physicists just don't know what's going on here. To learn more, we need to understand the fundamentals of physics a lot better. And that brings us to our final problem, the holy grail of the foundations of physics, the quest for a theory of everything. The question is this, is there one theory that can explain all of physics? Because right now, we have two, and they're kind of completely incompatible with each other. Physicists think there should be a theory of everything because lots of physics breakthroughs over the last two centuries have been some kind of unification. Like, Isaac Newton showed that the thing that makes apples fall from trees is the same thing that makes planets orbit the sun. Gravity. He demonstrated that two different phenomena in two different situations were governed by the same underlying principle. And that spirit of unification has also linked space and time, electricity and magnetism, and more. In fact, over the years, physicists have unified their theories down to two fundamental ones: Einstein's general relativity, or GR, and quantum field theory, or QFT. GR describes how gravity works, and QFT describes the other three fundamental forces: electromagnetism, the strong nuclear force, and the weak nuclear force. And the incredible thing is, everything in the entire universe can be explained using one or more of these four forces, even if it's super hard to do in practice. But general relativity and quantum field theory actually contradict each other at times, with results that can clash over things like extremely short distances or high energies. So the goal here is to find a deeper underlying structure that looks like QFT in some circumstances and like GR in others. Basically, one structure that explains both, and by extension, explains all of physics. That's a theory of everything. And there are lots of contenders. Each of them propose that there's one fundamental thing that the universe is made of, and everything manifests from that. The most popular idea is called string theory, and it says everything is made from one-dimensional vibrating strings, and all forces and types of matter come from their different vibrations. That said, we could spend hours talking about string theory or other ideas like loop quantum gravity, but there's zero evidence for any of these theories, and no prospects of that changing anytime soon. To find evidence for a theory of everything, we'd need to find where quantum field theory and general relativity break down. In other words, where they give the wrong predictions. That would hint at something deeper in physics. Except, those theories are too good so it's super difficult to find evidence against them. We do get rare hints, like the muon G-2 experiment, or dark energy in cosmology, which currently doesn't have a good explanation in either theory. But they're basically drops of water in a vast desert. Then again, finding a theory of everything was never going to be an easy task. A structure like that would also include dark matter, those hypothetical inflatons, and answers to things like the fine-tuning problem. So it's like asking to solve all of fundamental physics at once. Overall, there's a theme running through all these problems. For each of them, physicists use insights from the study of the smallest things in the universe and the largest things. They need to know about particle physics and cosmology. And there are loads more unsolved problems we could have talked about where that's the case too. It's a sign of how progress in physics is always interdisciplinary, and how the path forward is so long and daunting that we can only chart it by working together. Thanks for watching this episode of SciShow, which was brought to you, as always, with the help of our patrons. You guys truly make it possible for me to stand in front of this green screen and talk about impossible physics problems and bring the results to the whole entire internet. So thanks. To learn more, check out patreon.com/scishow.